What is going on, shrimp keepers? This is Rob with flipaquatics.com, and today we are at Danon's house. He's an avid saltwater fish reef keeper, and so I really don't know much about reef tanks, but you guys do know that I'm setting up a tank, so I needed to get some more insight, and so I've asked him a ton of questions. He's got a crazy system that I just have to show you. So stay tuned, and we're gonna go all through it.
So here's where the magic happens, as it were.
No, he's gonna be on the YouTube channel for sure. And now you are too.
No.
All right. So this is Danon. Danon, first of all, tell us a little bit about yourself. What do you do for a living, if you don't mind sharing?
And yeah. I'm a claims attorney for a medical malpractice insurance company. Like to do fish as my hobby and my relaxing getaway, I guess.
Nice. And so the fish club that we're at, it's the heart of America
Aquarium Society.
Aquarium Society. Mm-hmm. And it's in where?
Kansas City. We're the local fish group for Kansas City, the KC metro area, and the surrounding Missouri and Kansas areas. So.
And where can they find more information about your group?
We have a Facebook page, heartofamericaaquariumsociety.com, and then we also have a website, kcfishclub.com.
Awesome.
Sorry.
.org.
Yeah. .org. Get that right.
I'll put all that in the description down below.
Perfect.
But first of all, Dan, what's going on with this tank? How long has it been set up?
This one, it's been running about, I guess we're on to about 2.5, maybe close to 3 years. But yeah, that's my...
That's Champ.
That's the dog, yep. Mm-hmm.
2.5 to 3 years.
Yep. Now it's gone through some different changes, some rearranging of rock work, non-voluntary, but thanks to a fish that decided coral tasted pretty good, so had to tear it apart earlier this year and moved everything around and brought some stuff up from downstairs that had been down there and just kind of changed my main setup. So
has it always looked this good?
I'd like to think so, but probably not. I think it could always look better. You know, that's kind of anything in any part of the hobby. It can always do better.
Oh, absolutely. Now, this is the one that stood out to me right away. What'd you say this big guy was in the center?
It's a leather coral. I'm notoriously bad for remembering the trade name that it's for, but I'd say a neon green leather coral.
Very
but
cool.
Pretty easy, soft coral to keep, not super aggressive or anything like that.
What would you say your big key to success is for this tank?
I would say I was notoriously bad about not testing my parameters. You don't have to test your parameters all the time, but you really do need to know where they're at consistently, and you only can do that by doing it over a period of time. So just getting in that habit and figuring out, where your tank is happy at, and then I'd say dosing to keep those levels where they need to be. And then, testing every couple weeks, to make sure they're where they need to be, and if you notice something looks off, to just do a quick test, and even if you're just testing one parameter, I kind of will usually start with alkalinity, and if things look a little strange there, then I might investigate further.
But. Gotcha. So for someone that's a complete newbie, that knows nothing about reef keeping, what are the parameters you test for? Obviously, alkalinity, because you just said it.
Yeah, alkalinity would be important. You want to know your pH. Just like with freshwater, you want to know your ammonia, nitrates and nitrites. Calcium would be the other big one specific to reef. Magnesium would probably be, I'd say, alkalinity, magnesium, and calcium are your big three for reefing.
So those are the three that you dose?
Yes, yeah, and also some trace elements too. So
gotcha.
There are different companies out there that use different versions of the balling method, those are kind of your main three, and then there are some trace elements within those that are added as well.
So. Now, I'm completely a newbie to this. What's the balling method?
I'm not even going to try to explain it.
Is it pretty detailed?
Well, I just, you know, I am not the best person to ask about this. I am in no way an expert. I just have done what some other much smarter people than I have told me to do. So, and I've had success with it. But finding a good, three-part dosing system or even two-part dosing system, I think is really key. And again, I guess that's for a system this size. If you have a smaller system, then really I think, you know, you can more get away with just doing, larger water changes. But this is a close to 400-gallon system. So to continually do water changes that would add those, add the elements and the nutrients that I need would be a pretty big ask, so.
Gotcha. Now, you said this is about a 400-gallon system. Obviously, this is only about, what, 120 gallons?
Yep, 120.
And so there's a lot more to this tank that we haven't seen.
There's more going on back in the background.
All right, well, let's go check that
out. So here's where the magic happens, as it were. So we've got the bulk of the filtration going on in this area right here. So this is my refugium, this is where all my macroalgae are. That's what's going to suck up the excess nutrients and phosphates and those sorts of things. It's also a nice little haven for the good stuff you want, the copepods, the amphipods, stuff that your fish are going to eat, the coral are going to eat too. So all that stuff, I've given a large area for them to live and thrive, and I really think that's helped. And
I think you said something really interesting about the light. What do you do with the light that's...
Oh, right. Yeah, so I run the light opposite of the hours of my tank lights. So I do them at night when the other lights are off so that there's always some sort of photosynthesis happening, which definitely helps keep pH more stable throughout the day and night. So
very interesting. Mm-hmm. Now, I think this is crazy. You have a 100-gallon tank?
That's a 75, yeah.
That looks big. So it's a 75-gallon tank full of live rock and one eel. Ely Dan.
Ely Dan. Yeah, he usually only comes out if he's hungry. Or I guess if my daughter's down here, he seems to like her.
Yeah.
Hopefully not as looking at her as a snack or anything like that. Then we got, the starfish down there too. So, but yeah, this is again just in another area. You know, you're having biological filtration go on, but you're also giving places for those good little microfauna to live. Tiny brittle stars, the copepods, amphipods, stuff that your everything in your tank can feed on. So I just find the more space you have for stuff like this, the better your tank's going to do in the long run. Also helps with water stability. He's kind of poking his head out right there.
Is he? Oh, I see him. Ely Dan. Now, is there a reason that you don't have a light over this tank?
Yeah, so they are notorious for jumping out of the tank.
Okay.
They're much like, they're shaped like a snake. They can act like a snake sometimes. So there's been times where if I take this off and don't feed him fast enough, he's on the floor.
Oh, wow.
Wiggling around, yeah. So I've got to be pretty quick. When I have the food ready, I've got to start feeding him right away. Otherwise, he's going to jump out. He actually used to live upstairs. And I had him for about 2 days, and he disappeared. I thought he was dead. Just kind of decided to move on. I looked down in my sump a couple days later, and he'd taken up his home in there.
No, wait, so, this sump down here?
Yeah, this sump down here. He was living in there. He was much smaller at the time.
Gotcha.
I've had him for right at about a year.
And so I was upgrading my frag tank, and I was going to get rid of this tank. I just decided to keep it around, give him a nice little home, and I fortified this so that he wouldn't go down into the sun.
Gotcha. I like it. So how about this? How about just walk me through, like, from the display tank upstairs to what goes on with the filtration? Where does it go from there? Does the water flow to the top one, then to the bottom one?
Okay. So everything just flows down. Now the tank is actually split between this refugium and the sump. So the display tank splits between those two. I have a ball valve up there that I can shut that off so that water will just go to the sump.
Okay.
And then from there, all of the other tanks just dump directly into the sump itself. So, and no water gets pumped back up. So it's just gravity fed down this way. And the refugium itself is tied into the sump down here. So whatever goes in here eventually goes down there as well. So any of the copepods that are living in there, they'll wind up in the sump. From the sump, they get into this tank, into that tank, and then back upstairs.
So do you actually have to feed your coral?
You know, I do occasionally, but it's not something I do. I'm sure people will say I'm stupid for not doing it more often, but I just kind of rely mostly on the photosynthesis. I don't want to add a whole lot of the reef foods or get too carried away with it. I've done that before, and then you just wind up with you know, high ammonia, high levels and high phosphates, and when you have high phosphates, you know, just like with a freshwater tank, you wind up with algae, so I just try to avoid all that.
Yeah. Well, let's take a look at this tank.
Yeah.
And actually, first, this is your dosing setup.
Yep. Just a fairly basic dosing setup. This is for my three part that I was talking about. That's part of the balling method. So, like I said,
that we don't know anything about.
Yeah. It's some sort of magic that works. I don't know, but so it's set up to run certain times throughout the day, add the levels to hopefully keep them consistent. I'm still actually. I just switched to the three part. I was doing a combined one that I wasn't satisfied with. My calcium got way high, so I just let things ride for a little bit. I was dosing alkalinity only to get my calcium back down, and then everything kind of got to a baseline level, so I decided to start the three part. And so I'm still kind of dialing that in. I'm testing my alkalinity every day to make sure it's staying around where I want it. So
okay, because sometimes it might get too high, it might get too low.
Right, yeah, so you really need to figure out what your tank takes a day. But right now, since I'm a little deficient because I was trying to run through the calcium, not only am I trying to get back up to where I want to, but I don't want to overshoot that. So
gotcha.
I just kind of have to trial and error. And, you know, there are a lot of sites or companies that you buy this stuff from. The good ones will have some sort of calculator that tells you, you know, you can tell them what your levels are at, what you want them to be at, the size of your tank, and it can give you an idea of what you should be dosing. And the nice thing with at least this company's balling method, and I think really most of them, you're adding equal parts of each thing. So, you know, as long as I figure out I need to do 100 milliliters of alkalinity, that's how much I need to do of calcium, that's how much I need to do of magnesium.
Gotcha.
So it kind of makes things a little bit easier.
So where do you get this whole setup from?
Yeah. I actually got it from another hobbyist who had them. They were actually, I believe the dosing pump was new in box. It was from a store that actually went out of business, and she bought up their inventory and has been getting rid of some of that stuff. And I was looking at it, and you know, the nice thing about this, really, I mean, there are certainly not better pumps out there, but really what you want to look for is something where you can take off the head and replace it, because if you get into here, it's really just a tube, and so these can wear out over time. So you want to have one that you can replace the heads on. And that's
a good point.
Yeah, so that's really what you want to look for. This one's nice because it has an Android and an Apple app, so I can pull it up on my phone as long as I'm on my home Wi-Fi and can tell it, you know, how much to dose, when to dose.
Nice.
I have some other things like a low volume warning. It starts chirping if I run out.
Very cool. So tell me about this tank.
Yeah, so this one, I love bubble tips, but anyone who, you know, gets into corals for any amount of time, they'll realize very quickly bubble tips love to move. You can put them in a tank, and they'll stay still for a long time, and then suddenly they'll just decide to move and sting your favorite coral. So I wanted to have bubble tips, but I didn't want to have them in my display. So I just set up this 20-gallon long. This actually, I guess how it started, was my frag tank. You know, originally it was the upstairs.
Nice.
This sump and the refugium in the sump.
Okay.
And then I decided I'm going to get a frag tank. So I started with the 20-gallon long, filled it up in about 3 months, and decided I need a bigger frag tank. So I had that 75-gallon, and I switched that to my frag tank. Wasn't a great size for it, so I eventually looked for a 50-gallon low boy, kind of a classic frag tank,
yeah,
and switched to that. So this was originally my first frag tank, and then I had it here. It was already tied in. I'd done all the work, so I decided I was ready for a bubble tip, and I'd let it live there. Don't need to worry about it going around seeing coral. So I started with a rainbow and added a couple different varieties and just kind of let it do its thing. I have a couple hosting clownfish, which are fun. So, you know, I'd love to have, you know, maybe someday a big display of just bubble tips, but I'll never have bubble tips in with any corals I care about ever again.
No, it's not worth it.
Yeah, you learn from that mistake once.
So this was your first frag tank.
Yep.
This was your second one.
Yep.
And then this is the third one.
Yeah, this is the last one here. Well, probably not the last one. There'll probably be another one at some point in the future.
Wow.
So at this point, this is just kind of overflow. There's no really rhyme or reason to what I've picked and why it's there. But
just kind of whatever made its way here.
Yeah, you know, I go someplace and I think, hey, that's a cool pool. So I pick it up and throw it down here until I decide where I want it, or it could be something. A lot of these come from bigger pieces upstairs that I've accidentally fragged, and I put them down here, and then I get my hand in the tank and frag it again, and just kind of an ongoing crisis, I guess.
Now, with fish, are coral kind of the same that you have to quarantine?
So yeah, you if you're smart, you probably should. But I'm not necessarily smart. With coral, the really important thing would be dipping. You should dip all your coral. People have different methods. I'm just currently using, what am I using? Revive Coral Cleaner, which is by what is it? Two Little Fishes. And that's great, but there are probably better, stronger ones out there. I like Coral RX, but I had trouble getting it at my local stores. Some people use a Bayer insect killer. I've never done that, but a lot of people swear by that, and I can imagine.
Interesting.
Yeah, I can imagine. You know, if it does a good job killing insects, it'll kill a lot of those hitchhikers that you don't want. So,
oh, absolutely.
And that's what's really important. And you know, you'd be really smart to do a full quarantine, because some of these pests, you may kill the living pests, but if they're eggs, some of these dips might not get there. And so, you know, I think some people say, particularly for aquaporin eating flatworms, you know, Bayer might kill the eggs. I think there's a lot of people out there, though, that would say it doesn't, you know, wouldn't kill the eggs. And the only way to be sure you don't have them is by, you know, physical examination or scrubbing them off or quarantining them and you know, doing a treatment that way over a period of time. So
gotcha. So I do notice that you got some Fritzol here. Is this all you use, or?
Yeah, that's my go-to. Fritz is a great coral, a great salt. You know, it's definitely, I feel like I've noticed an increase in popularity around this area. A lot of people using that. I feel I'm getting the most bang for my buck out of it, so that's why I like to stick with that.
That's awesome. Mm-hmm. So Fritz is the go-to salt. Now, what's the difference between the red and the blue?
So the red is more for like SPS. It's going to be more for hard coral dominated systems, at least what I understand. I haven't really looked at it too much. My systems. Probably a little more LPS, soft coral heavy. I do have some SPS, but probably not as much. So, but you know, again, I think it's kind of one of those things, depending on how much you're dosing, what you're dosing. You know, I think that seems to be more important to me, to get your parameters right. I'm actually trying to do fewer water changes now that I'm dosing, because I'm kind of relying on that to replenish what I need. But I think, you know, there are some people that, that do nothing but dosing and don't do water changes and just top off with fresh water. But I think, yeah, what are you getting into, Trent? Breaking something? You know, I think you can't get away from doing at least some water changes. And,
yeah.
And they're never bad, you know, unless obviously you have some issues with your city water. But it's always, you know, good to introduce some new water into the system. You know, especially from a good salt. So
from a guy that is trying to minimize water changes, how many water changes would you recommend?
Trying to minimize water changes?
Yeah, like for your system, like what's your basic? Is it once a week? Is it every 3 weeks?
Before I started dosing, I was doing it about once a week. That was my goal.
Okay.
But I travel for work, those sorts of things, so it never quite happened. I think I'm probably on to week 4 or 5 now. Without doing a water change.
Oh, wow.
So, you know, I would say perfect would be I'd do 1 55-gallon water change on this a month. But really, I feel comfortable with the dosing and with checking my parameters to stretch that out to, you know, a month and a half, maybe even 2. So, just kind of depends what I have time for.
That's awesome.
Yeah. And if anything's suffering, you know.
So, I know I asked you this earlier, but obviously, everyone always thinks like reef keeping is extremely hard. Now, you said it, the setup is the hard part, but once you get it going, it's pretty easy.
Right, yeah, yeah. Once you figure out, you know, what you need, you get, you know, good equipment, that's really the hard part. And, you know, even just the setup as far as the water initially, the parameters, you know, having it cycled, making sure you have the right amount of alkalinity, calcium, magnesium, having those levels in the right place then kind of lets you build upon that.
Gotcha.
And then once you get there, you get stuff in the system, you start measuring what it's taking out of your system, you start dosing. So, you know, really I'd say key, again, we're talking about a bigger system, so with the nano tank, it's a little different. You can get away with maybe just an ATO auto top off and adding more frequent water changes. But for a system like this, I'd say must-haves, auto top off, a dosing system, and then some sort of controller so that you know your temperatures are in the right place, you have redundancies built in if something goes wacky and you know, can kind of shut the tank off before things get too out of hand.
Excellent. Well, I ask everyone this question. If you could give one piece of advice to everyone watching, what would it be?
Find a cheaper hobby. No.
That's funny.
My one piece of serious advice is even on those tough days, you know, take everything in stride because it's those hard days that really let you know how dedicated to this hobby you are. You know, it's the tough days that you go through to get experience the good days.
Yeah.
So, you know, it sucks when you flood a tank or, you know, you screw something up and you kill a bunch of stuff, but, you know, it's those days that make the days where you're actually just going to sit and look at your tank that much more enjoyable.
There you guys have it. So, Danon, thank you so much, first of all, for inviting me to your club to speak. I'm doing
Thanks
a talk tomorrow.
Yeah.
And I'm super excited. It's going to be a great time. We're going to go see some other fish rooms, but thank you for sharing some knowledge and what you do here, and I guess we're going to go eat some Vietnamese food.
All right, sounds good.
All right, thank you. See you guys.